everybody, welcome to finalize these sessions on upscaling sanitation at the city level. And thanks SEI for this very good vegetarian food. It was very good, perfect. And I think everybody is ready now for the last 15 minutes of these sessions. We will have one presentation from our colleague Daniel, but before, our colleague from Kenya has a few words to say to you.
No, just very quick, thank you so much for listening to our presentation, but I just wanted to announce that, you'll know the genesis later, but we have the CWE equivalent in Africa, 20th of November to 25th at KICC, Kenyatta International Conference Center in Nairobi. If you can check out our website, you can register yourself. The idea behind and why I want to announce it here is because we are looking at innovation in both water and sanitation between our entire university. And then we're inviting companies from Europe and North America and also Latin America to come and display their products. There's one thing to have products actually developed here and they come to us, but I'm asking the companies to come to Kenya and show us. First of all, you know, you have to know our problems, first of all. And then when you go back, hopefully we'll have it yearly. So I'm just taking this opportunity to invite everyone to look at our website and register. Tafadhali. Thank you so much. Karibuni Kenya.
Thank you very much. So you're welcome in Nairobi, yes, for all of you. So now we will, for the last presentation of these sessions, we will speak about new topics. And this is for this session is the question of resource recovery from sanitation. So Daniel, I'll let you introduce yourself and do the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The presentation I'm going to give right now is from work that I did as part of my master's thesis at KTH, Royal Institute of Technology, prominently displayed right there, but also working within the Sustainable Sanitation Initiative here at SCI with Anna Rosmarine, Kim Andersson, and other colleagues in that team. Now, what is, you know, the motivation for us moving into resource recovery? This is basically that we need to revamp sanitation from, you know, a sector that is associated with dangerous waste flows to a sector that is associated with productive resource flows. And this is not just the public health benefits that come from having improved sanitation in all areas and, you know, in the context of cities for this session specifically, but also other productive resource flows, because when you recover energy, nutrients and other possible resource recovery or reuse products from sanitation, then you have a multitude of co-benefits that you can get from sanitation rather than just public health benefits. And this is really the motivation for the tool that we have developed here at KCI, at SCI and KTH. And the tool basically is meant to estimate the reuse products that we can get from sanitary waste streams, so fecal sludge, sewage sludge, you know, wastewater and other waste flows in the urban context, name it. And then also the potential revenues that we could get from these reuse products if, you know, necessary investments are made to have technologies that can capture these resources. And this tool also is able to make a comparison between the different resource recovery products that are available. So these are basically the capabilities of the tool as it is right now. So this is what the tool does. But why do we need to have a tool, you know, in any case? You know, global estimates have been made of the potential value that can be captured out of sanitary waste, specifically fecal sludge or sewage sludge. There's already projects that have, you know, attempted to capture the global value within human excreta or wastewater or fecal sludge or whatever form it might be. For example, this is a report that was published last year, and I tried to estimate the potential benefits that we could get if all human excreta from the entire globe was turned into some form of energy. So there's a potential market value of $9.5 billion annually, imagine. There is also another study that has been done to try to capture the global potential of phosphorus recovery. And, you know, it has been mapped very clearly according, you know, to country and continent or regional level with scenarios both for 2009 and then in the future as well. But we all realize that whereas it's good to have a global picture of the potential, the necessary investments, the necessary action that needs to be taken to realize this global potential is at the local scale. at city level, at town level, in the local area. That's where the necessary action needs to be taken for us to realize this global potential, these global strategies. But sadly, the tools that have been developed so far to try to capture, you know, the potential of resource recovery are either focused on one waste stream or one resource recovery option, and most of them are geared towards the context of the global north. So this leaves out the countries in the global south where, as we know, the majority of our population growth is going to take place in the next few decades. So this is the inspiration for the tool that we are making. We want it to be something that is comprehensive, that covers, you know, a wide range of waste streams, a wide range of resource recovery options, and fits both contexts, both in the global south and in the global north. How does the tool work? Revamp. I'm going to demonstrate briefly. The tool, we tested it in Kampala, and these are the waste stream flows that we have in Kampala for the different waste streams, as you can see, both for current generation or current collection rates, but then also the potential if the city improved its collection systems and in terms of efficiency and coverage. So I will jump right to Microsoft Excel briefly. Okay, sorry about that. I'm not sure how to get this away from PowerPoint. I tried doing that, but then it just brings up that blank screen. Just to display the Excel.
Okay.
I think here, right here.
Bring it out? No.
You want to? Yeah. Let me try this.
Mm. Maybe we just have to stop square. We just have to say, don't just duplicate. Yes. Okay. Hopefully they get it there.
Okay. All right. As a student of technology, I should have been able to cover this. Okay. Anyway, so this is the tool. As you can see, in present form, it's in spreadsheets. So we have four spreadsheets. There's some few instructions for the user to follow. There is a model, and this is basically the main part of this tool that we have developed, as you can see. So at the top, you can see there is different waste streams, fecal sludge, for example, sewage sludge, and at the moment, we also have organic municipal solid waste. And in the yellow boxes, the user can put in the amounts of the waste stream that they have in their city. So for example, in Kampala, there is 390 cubic meters of fecal sludge. There is 66 tons of sewage sludge that can be generated every day. And as far as solid waste is concerned, 700 cubic meters. And then you can, tons per day. And then you can see estimates for biogas in terms of the amount, the energy value, the potential revenue, as well as the nutrient content within the residue. And you can see the same for the other resource recovery options, solid fuel, potential animal feed ingredients from black soldier fly larvae, as well as fertilizer, if some of that of those waste streams are composted. And then the estimates that we see here in terms of minimum, typical, and maximum, to give a range. And that's why we have called it estimate. It's not the actual values. And these calculations are based on the characterization data of these different waste streams. So we have a worksheet there on characterization data. This comes with the tool, but if these characterization studies that have been done in the city or in the particular local area, they can feed in this data so that they have a more accurate picture. But most of this is based on literature and it's representative. Then we also have some graphs, to give the comparison that I talked about. So we can see in terms of potential revenues, if all these waste streams, for example, were geared towards biogas and the residues in terms of nutrients, this is the revenue that you could potentially generate. The yellow bit, the orange bit is the typical values, and then we have the maximum and minimum estimates. And so we can see, for example, that if you used it for solid fuel, either in form of powder or briquette form or pellets, then you could have much higher revenue potential there. And there's also estimates for the nutrients and also for the energy content. So a city can make a choice based on, you know, do we need to have more fertilizer generated from within the area instead of importing urea? Or do we need to create, you know, to have an alternative source of energy? Or do we need to, you know, just maximize revenues? And, you know, that can help them make a decision. So getting back to PowerPoint, just to give an overview of the potential within Kampala, as you can see, for the three waste streams, for the scenario of what is collected daily at the moment, we could have about 115 cubic meters of biogas every day from the daily collection of these three waste streams. And this is enough to substitute the daily firewood that is used by about 263,000 people. So there's a lot of potential there, as well as, you know, you can see the other resource recovery options and their value as substitutes. This tool is not intended to be used as a standalone tool. It fits within the overall sanitation planning and other, you know, the wider city planning tools that are available. So you can see there is a potential, for example, to fit it up with the tool that has been developed by RRC, because, you know, it produces fecal flow volumes. And this is the data that we need in Revamp. So you can fit it together with other tools, clues, you know, Sanitation 21, the compendium of sanitation technologies, and a wide range of other tools. But not only for sanitation, here we are talking about energy, we are talking about food production, we are talking about fertilizer. So it's not just sanitation. There's a wider range of issues that come together, and this tool can be a very good complement to the other tools that are already being used for city planning. And it's also very, you know, it fits into the wider sustainable development agenda, because if you recover energy, you know, that's energy is available there. Then if you don't have excreta flowing into the open environment, then we're having much better ecosystems in the city area. We have, if we recover nutrients, then we have food security. If we don't have waste flows, you know, openly in the environment, then we have people having a better public health. Then, of course, there's revenues that can be generated, creating green businesses and opportunities for green jobs. And, of course, water security as well, if the water streams in the area are not contaminated by these fecal flows or other forms of waste material. So it fits, you know, within the wider sustainable development agenda, both at urban scale but even national scale, and then we can realize the global potentials in these resource flows. So what's next? We intend to do further work on this tool, improve the user interface, integrate with other tools for Nexus planning, for a Nexus approach to planning, and also include other variables, of course, the costs, both for investment at the beginning and then operation, and also testing it in a varied range of towns and cities to improve it based on feedback from the users and other stakeholders. And we welcome partners that are interested in joining in this work at all levels. This just to credit people that have been involved in this project. So thank you very much.
Presentations. So if you have any question of clarification or any remarks, it's welcome. Maybe I could try with first questions. In your Excel sheet, you speak about sewage sludge. Do you speak about wastewater? Unless the sludge part of the wastewater?
The sludge, where? Specifically. So after some form of either activated sludge treatment or some form of treatment, the sludge that remains. Yeah, not the effluent. Mm-hmm. But of course, there is value in that as well. You know, for example, if it's reclaimed water that can be used for irrigation, and those are aspects that we intend to include in the tool in further steps in the future.
Okay. Thank you. Roland.
Thanks, Daniel. Great. I think it's an excellent introduction to what I'm going to talk a little bit later.
Thank you.
But my question is, did you, you know, with these impressive numbers on energy, do you talk to people who are dealing with energy? Do you talk to people who want to have sustainable energy, but they never talk about sanitation, they never talk about water?
At the moment, that hasn't been done to a great extent. When we tried out the tool in Kampala, it was only with the Public Health and Environment Directorate within the Kampala Capital City Authority, and that was just the first step. And I should also note that this is just work that has been done so far in 6 months, so there's a lot of, you know, there's a long way to go. And like, we realize that this is not something for the sanitation sector only, because it involves, like I explained, so many other sectors that and other stakeholders that need to be brought to the table to discuss together. So I think that's something that, you know, we really need to do going forward.
Yeah. Any other comments? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You said you tested the tool in Kampala.
Yes.
What kind of impact did it have? Did it lead to some developments on the ground with some political choices and maybe trials on new energy generation?
At the moment, no concrete decisions have been made basing on this tool, but we intend to engage stakeholders further as we develop the tool and as we improve it. But in Kampala, there is a very good political goodwill, you know, from the stakeholders involved. There is a lot of projects that are ongoing. I know some of the people in this room have been involved in projects in Kampala, so I think there is a lot of potential. One example I could give, the World Bank funded lots of projects in different urban centers in Uganda to obtain value from organic wastes in the cities. And most of these projects were centered around composting facilities. And, you know, money was offered to Kampala. Kampala said, no, let other cities do, you know, composting. But for us, we want to do something to do with energy. So this is already something that they are thinking about. So there is, of course, some synergies between these projects and the ongoing political decisions that are being taken within the city in Kampala. So, but we intend to do, you know, more engagement with the stakeholders there. And yeah. Because this tool can't work on its own. It's not something to be done at SCI. It can only have impact, really, if all the stakeholders and the people that, you know, it's intended to benefit are on board.
Yeah. Thank you. One last question? Yeah.
You're making the difference between income from the energy and, for example, nutrients. But, I mean, if you use it for energy, there are also, there's a leftover, which can also be used, I mean, for further, or to produce fertilizer. So yeah. Have you been looking at that?
Yes, if you noted, I can't go back right now because of time, but those values in terms of revenues that I showed capture both the energy and the residue. So that's taken into account. It was not just the energy. So for example, for biogas, there is a residue that comes from biogas digestion. So that was accounted for. So that graph includes both the potential revenues from the biogas as well as the residue.
So thank you very much, Daniel, for
thank you
very
much.
Useful presentations. I know that we have a lot of discussions still today, so I will try to summarize very shortly the discussions we had since this morning regarding this session on upscaling sanitation at urban level. I just switched to recall the what Alejandro say us at the beginning of this session to say us that we know, all of us, that we have a very strong challenge regarding sanitations, urban sanitation particularly, and we have ready to go beyond the local action, to go at city level, to think about national levels, really to not don't speak about only about small projects, but to really upscale the activities. We have a lot of very interesting presentations, so I really wish to thank all of you, all the presenters, for your presentation. I think it was very useful. It was, I think, a broad view, but a broad travel in the urban sanitation cycle, so thank you very much. It's difficult to summarize all the elements, but I think it was very useful because we had a lot of elements regarding the assessment of the situations on what we could do. We have elements regarding the assessment through the ASFD, the sheet flow diagram. We had also to have an overview of this sheet flow. We have also elements through the SANIPAS to specifically assess the question of public health risk linked to sanitation. I think it was very complementary. And we just have with Danielle this also these questions of resource recovery. How could we consider also sanitation effluents as on their potential of resource recovery? So I think it was very useful. Martin gave us also very interesting elements with the FSM tools to explain that we have to take into consideration all these elements regarding assessment. We could work based on that on the elaboration of strategy and to implement all these elements. I really appreciate one of the elements of Martin highlight this morning is also that we have to consider not only in one side the on-site system, on another side the sewage systems, but really to think always when we are in a city to think of the complementarity between these two systems and don't think about only one. I think it's very crucial point. I think it was very useful also for us to have the presentation from our colleague from Kenya to say we speak about how to upscale, and they show us an interesting tools. These trust funds they use, how these trust funds could help the innovations, coming directly from the utilities themselves. I think it's a very useful tools and tools that help to elaborate pilot project at the beginning, but also mainly try to upscale these pilot activities. So I think following all these elements, we have a lot of elements. We know that it's at the earth of the work of most of us. We have a lot of work to continue to do together. But I think it's very important to have this opportunity together, and thanks to SuSanA to give this opportunity to share all this experience. So thank you very much, and I let
Just have a short announcement. If you want to keep discussing on citywide sanitation and urban sanitation, we have a side event at the World Water Week tomorrow at 9, in which we'll be presenting 9 cases. So as it's the registration, so I kindly ask you to get there earlier to get your badges and be able to be at the side event in time.
Okay, thank you.
Can you ask the next chair?
Okay, we're coming to the next session 3. We're only like 10 minutes behind schedule, so it's great. Huh? It's sustainable sanitation in the Agenda 2030 and the international water architecture. We have a number of contributions to this. First, as I announced in the morning, Roland will walk us through the background document and maybe a new sort of amendment to the vision or a new document that will bring us towards the SDGs, and we'll share that with you, and we'll ask for some feedback from you. We'll further discuss it in the core group tomorrow, and we'll share it more broadly then from January onwards. But to keep you in the loop and as well to have your reactions, Roland will embark on that. That's the broader picture. We'll have then a couple of sort of focused contributions. One is that SEI has produced a new book, which is actually very useful for that discussion, and Kim Andersson will present that to us. And then I'm very happy that Daniela Krahl from the German Ministry has joined us. It's the first time that the German Ministry is here in this 22nd SuSanA meeting. That's great. I think you trust us, you look at us, you listen to us, what we report to you, but you help us going since almost 10 years. So great that you're here. And you'll speak about that business as usual is not an option to fulfill the 2030 agenda, and that the global architecture in the water sector, how could it look like to really get things going? We'll have Kate Medlicott. She might still be in a UN meeting, but she wanted to tell us about the whole area of monitoring in the sanitation goal in the SDGs. And those who sneaked in during lunch and looked at the MOOC, that was Kate. So we'll have her here live then as well. And then as India is sort of a bigger part of the game, and the Indian president had that Swachh Bharat Clean India, and how is it going? We have the Indian chapter. We will ask Vishwanath to give us his perception. How is that going? How does that fit as well into 2030 and really get things done? And I know you'll have your very interesting view on that. So without further ado, I would ask Roland. We are sharing it together, and let us know what's going on. Maybe I sit next to you.
Yes, thanks very much, Daniel. Well, good afternoon. I know this good food that you had requires all the attention from your body. So, but I hope that you still can spare some attention of what I'm going to talk about. Actually, you know, we said already this morning, we are in the period of changing from the MDGs to the SDGs. And when we started discussing in SuSanA what this might mean, or what this should mean for SuSanA, we said it's probably a good idea to have a background paper, though, that we are all on the same level of information. And so we, together with Elisabeth Kvarnström and Patrick Bracken, we wrote this background paper. I hope there are still copies around. They were on the chair. So I would quickly go through that. What we wanted to do with this background paper is actually just see what are the main changes from the MDGs to the SDGs, and showing that sanitation is not only related to SDG 6, but basically to all other SDGs. And in my opinion, this is a great opportunity. One can regret that there are 17 SDGs, but I see it more as an opportunity for SuSanA to enter into these other themes as well. So I will talk a little bit about that, and then of course what that all means for SuSanA. And we had already some preliminary talks and some inputs from the core group, and we will continue with that tomorrow. And of course, everybody is welcome to give their comments. So let me see, how do I go here? Is that okay? Just a few words about the development of the SDGs for those who are maybe not aware what really happened. I'd like to remind ourselves that in 2012 at the Rio Plus 20, it was decided to have SDGs as successor of the MDGs. And then in 12 till 14, there was an open working group working on this, an extremely open process with all the pros and cons. I will come back to that. And I think part of this process, we also should be aware of this conference in August in 2015 in Addis Ababa, talking about financing. How do we finance these SDGs? And I think for me it was very important, it was a long, very difficult discussion, to realize and to say that really new resources are necessary. And at the top is domestic public resources. We have to mobilize more domestic resources. Domestic and international private business and finance, and of course still ODA. And then, as you all know, in September 2015, these 17 SDGs were adopted. And of course for us, the 6 is the one. And I was actually part also with SDC fighting that we have an SDC, one on water, and actually the existing one is about 90% what we actually suggested how it should look like. So if you are not happy with it, you can also claim it a bit to us. So what are the main difference between the SDGs and the MDGs? Well, first of all, this process, very inclusive goal-setting process. And as a result of that also, it's much, much more comprehensive. We had 8 MDGs, now we have 17 SDGs 169 targets. Well, some people, how can we deal with this? Well, it is a challenge. I think one of the real big change that SDG Agenda 2030 is no more a development agenda, it's a sustainability agenda. So they are universal goals. They are applicable for all countries, for Zambia as well as for Switzerland. Of course, not in the same way. I don't think in Switzerland open defecation free communities is a big issue. But there are other SDGs which are a big issue also for Switzerland. Sustainable production, sustainable consumption. This is much more important for Germany or Switzerland than it is for Zambia. So I think that is very important. And we will talk about what does that mean for SuSanA. And then they are much more ambitious. You remember, many of the goals, one wanted just to go halfway through. Now we have to go all the way through, zero. And one of the real important ones, leaving no one behind. Leaving no one behind. And, you know, I'm very old now. I remember when I entered into this whole sector, that was the beginning of the water and sanitation decade. And you know the motto was then, in 1980, water and sanitation for all by 1990. You know where we are today. The motto was also some for all instead of all for some. Motto still very actual as today. So we are not talking about new things, basically. And I mentioned the funding. I mean, the MDGs were supposed to be funded mainly by ODA. Now it's a different type of funding and a setup that we have to look at. Well, related to water, you all know MDGs. We didn't have a water or a goal. It was just under goal 7. The proportion of the population without sustainable water and sanitation should be reduced by half. Now we have really this SDG number 6 with 6 main targets and 2 targets related to means of implementation. And, you know, these are the two WASH, how I call them, the WASH targets. And we have the wastewater management target. And I was stealing this figure from that publication here because it shows very nicely what's the difference between MDGs and SDGs related to water and sanitation. You see on the left, MDGs. Now we are talking about the whole system when we address the SDGs. And then, of course, we have the 6.4, finally talking about use efficiency, ensure sustainable withdrawals. And I think in the one before, of course, recycling and safe reuse. You know, and I mean, coming to what Daniel was just talking about, that's how important that is. Now, we have then the water resources management target. And of course, we have also the target on protecting ecosystems. So much more complex. And then we have the two means of implementation targets. Now, what are the developments in the sanitation sector during the MDG period? And so for me, the most important change is this profile of sanitation, which increased really in. When I think back in the year 2000, I mean, talking about these things, people ridiculed us. Even in my institution at EAWAG, the classical engineers, they said, what are you talking about? We know what to do. We know sewer systems is the solution. Come on, I mean, you are just ridiculous. Now, the same people realize suddenly, hey, even in our countries, maybe that not may be the way to go. And I think this is, so now looking at this systems approach, in the year 2000, nobody talked about, well, some people talked about, but very few. And I think the big change, we still talk about the same things, basically, but many more people talk about the same things, many more bright people about talk, because I always said, the sanitation challenge is so big and so difficult, only the brightest people have to work in it. And because, you know, it's relatively easy to design a system sanitation for Zurich. It's relatively easy. But to design a sanitation system for Dar es Salaam, it's incredibly difficult. We still don't know yet, or in India. I mean, people are still working on it and very successfully, but I think you are far away of saying we know the solution, so we are still working. But so for me, it's very nice to see that so many more people and bright people are finally working in this field, which was so unsexy for many, many, many years. So that point is for me also very important, that even in so-called industrialized countries, developed countries, people more and more are realizing that we need a paradigm shift also in our systems. I mean, people in Sweden have been talking about that for many, many years, but there were only a few, and it really didn't get across. And many people gained access to so-called improved sanitation, no question. But, and here is the big but still 2.4 billion are still using an improved, you know, these numbers, including the more than the 1 billion people who are still practicing open defecation. And I think for me, this is really also very, very disturbing. You know, it shows the big inequality between urban and rural, between poor and rich. And although in 2010, it was declared water and sanitation is a human right, and now recently even sanitation itself is a human right. If you look at this picture, we are far away from this human right. You know, it just shows the poorest quintile to the richest quintile. Now, I think sanitation relates to nearly all of the other SDGs. I don't go through it. I think we elaborated quite a bit in this paper here how these relations are, because we wanted to actually motivate people, especially also the working groups, to open their eyes. You know, and I take now the energy one. And that's why I'm so grateful for Daniel's number he showed. The clean energy. I was participating in some of the energy people meeting before the SDGs. And they were very concerned that there will be an energy goal. Great. There was not one word about sanitation, about byproducts of sanitation maybe being helping to achieve this target. There were many little things about water. So I think, I feel that this is a great opportunity now for SuSanA to get into these different SDGs and to talk to people, to talk to energy people, to talk nutrition people, health people, that we did for long, education people. So I think nearly all of these SDGs are direct or indirectly linked to sanitation, and I would like to be people aware of that. This is a big opportunity. Now, coming to the what does that mean for SuSanA? Like I said, we had already preliminary discussions with the core group. We also did a survey. Based on this background paper, we asked several questions. And how the discussion looks at the moment, and we will have it much more discussion tomorrow with the core group. this new document, which will be either an amendment or a new document. And you ask maybe yourself, why an amendment? Well, I was involved in the development of a vision paper in 2008. And it's actually the only document that all members, all partners of SuSanA subscribed. There are many documents that SuSanA had was involved, but this was only the only one that it, and it was a long process that everybody could agree with that. So in a way, it's a constitution of SuSanA, and we said, why reopen this discussion again? But it's not decided yet if it will be an amendment. Anyway, but content-wise, it will look probably very similar. So we will have, of course, introduction. We will have a short description about from the MDGs to the SDGs, what I just showed you now in a nutshell. And then it came out that we really have to have a definition for sanitation. In our vision document, we never had a clear definition what SuSanA means for, what sanitation means for SuSanA, and I think we have to do that, especially now that wastewater comes in. How do we relate to that? Some people say, well, solid waste should be in too. I think we need this operational definition. It will be a hard work that everybody can agree, but I think we will do that. I think we need a statement how Target 6.2, the sanitation, is related to the wastewater. How is that related to each other? I think that some people were very unhappy that we had 6.3 in, because they said, well, that takes away the attention from 6.2. And there should no competition there. But we have to make a clear statement how these are related to each other. What does universality and leave nobody behind mean for SuSanA, these two very important points? I think it is quite unanimously clear that I think SuSanA shall still focus on the low and middle income countries, but it will also look at newer developments in the industrialized countries and use as a showcase that there are alternatives to the conventional wastewater systems. It also comes out quite clear that SuSanA's work will put more emphasis on the hardest to reach and most vulnerable, and the word here is more, not only, but maybe a little bit more than in the past. And I think it was mentioned already before, I think SuSanA's working groups shall take up access to all and upscaling as a cross-cutting issue and address them it from their specific thematic angle. So that's how this document probably will look like. And I just would like to invite you, if you have some strong opinion, if you have some ideas, please, I think you can fill in this form here at the end, or you can tell us so that we can bring it into the discussion with a core group, with the heads of the different working groups. And then, of course, we also had these two questions. How can SuSanA contribute to end open defecation in a sustainable way? You know, CLTS is sort of almost a silver bullet now. I think CLTS has a great merit. But on the other hand, I think, there was just a big book came out on sustainability of CLTS. And we said, oh, great, that's now covered sustainable issues. But if you look at it, it just shows how sustainable, for them, sustainable is just not turning back to open defecation. That's for them sustainability. For SuSanA, sustainability is a little bit more than that. And so I think we probably will have to develop sort of a statement on that, a little bit, not criticizing CLTS, but to to show that you know, how can CLTS become a sustainable system. And then we need interpretation of target 6.2 and 6.3, because, you know, one of the philosophy of the SDG is really that these global targets have to be translated now into national targets. This is very important. And I think SuSanA could really play an important role in assisting that, especially with regard to 6.3. There are no global indicators for recycling, reuse. And I think this is at the core of SuSanA in a way. So I think SuSanA could really play here an important role assisting governments how to translate these international targets into national targets. Because, you know, it's a big agenda, 2030, but it's a framework. And it's now up to the governments to come up with their targets. And the big advantage for me in Agenda 2030 is that people have now the right to ask the governments, what are you doing about these things? I think this shouldn't be underestimated. Civil society gets a stronger role in this. Okay, I think that's all what I wanted to share with you today. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Roland, for that most insightful view of the opportunities. I think just adding to what Roland said, we really are have a golden opportunity now to influence the development agenda. And I know from on Roland's last slide that many countries are crying out. They're crying out for technical guidance on how to measure these indicators. So they're going to be calling on the SuSanA group at WIDE for this for assistance in this area. And it's absolutely critical. We have a small window to do this, so be prepared. Anyway, I'd like to open the floor up for comments to Roland or any questions or clarifications that you have. So please, who would like to kick off the conversation? Okay.
Hi, Christine Moe, Emory University. I really liked your presentation and contrasting and comparing the MDGs and the SDGs. I think one important aspect of SDG 6 that we've been interested in is the extension of WASH into institutions and particularly healthcare facilities. And I think that sanitation in healthcare facilities is more complex than household sanitation. And so I just wondered if you wanted to comment on that. I think we've been working in this area for the past 5 years, and we realize that we need some better indicators for healthcare facilities. WHO and UNICEF is working on this, but I think it's an area where there's still quite a few information gaps.
Thanks. Cook. Do you want to go ahead and?
I fully agree with you, and a lot still has to be done. My plea also would be, you know, we have the target, the SDG on education, and I think we should also get with the education people. I mean, no school is a good school if they don't have good sanitation facilities. So it's not only that we among ourselves and tell people what should be done. I think we also have to reach out that these people in the education field, they also realize, hey, that's a problem that we have to tackle.
Thanks. Next comment, somebody else from India.
Yeah, I'm Antoinette Koma. From SNV. I haven't read the paper, so maybe it's inside of the paper, but I was wondering what your thoughts are about the target 6.5, the integrated water resources management, mm-hmm. and its relation to sanitation. Do you think that will divert us, or that it will improve, or whether you have any thoughts?
Well, What I can tell you that this was the most controversial target
because of the between the countries, you know, the
transboundary.
Thank you very much. Because that was the biggest issue. But I didn't have too much thought, and I don't think that it will deviate our attention too much. Why do you think it will?
In many of the presentations, conversations that we've been having, it was about district-wide sanitation or working with municipal authorities on sanitation in their area, because it is their duty, basically. Of course, if we bring in a watershed perspective, that is also transboundary in that sense. And it's a whole different dynamic again. We haven't been talking about that in SuSanA. I don't know if I would advocate for that, but I think we need to think about it, what it means, because there is this push to look at it on a watershed level.
Good point. Let's think about this. Although, of course, I know water is really an issue of river basin. That is no question. How far it is related to sanitation, to a lesser degree. But that's a very, very good input. I think we will think about that.
Hi, thanks. That was very interesting. And there's a lot of interest, I think, in looking at synergies across the SDGs. But I think it would be interesting to look at the potential trade-offs as well. So areas where you have either targets canceling each other out or just constraining each other. So to look at how sanitation might have, if we're talking about progressive realization of sanitation, are there potential interactions with the goals on aquatic ecosystems, for instance? So looking at that as well, and not just the positive synergies, but also the potential trade-offs.
Yeah, very good point. Something I forgot to say, actually, is that when we have these 17 SDGs, some of them completely in conflict with each other. You know, if we talk protection of environment, reducing resource use, and then economic development, you know, there are really conflicts there. But I think the nice thing about it is that I think governments have to start to talk about this. You know, when we talk about water, I have been involved in water also in Switzerland. Water is always full of conflicts. And it's actually the society, it has to be a civil contract, how this is dealt with. how much water goes to energy, how much water goes to water supply, how much water goes to industry. So I think having these conflicts, I think it's very good to open up that there are conflicts, that there are synergies, but there are also conflicts. So that's another opportunity, I think.
Thank you very much, Roland. I think we'll bring this discussion to a close now because we're under time pressure. Thank you very much again, Roland, for your excellent presentation. The next presentation is from Kim Andersson from SEI, who's going to talk to us about their joint publication. Kim.
So it's really great that Roland has kind of set a scene. This is a joint effort with the UNEP SEI. But also co-authoring from the Swedish Technical Research Institute with Elizabeth Kwanström and Jennifer McConville, Rasek Sader from the University of Technology of Norway. And SEI colleagues of mine, Rosemarin, Sarah Dickin, and Casper Trimmer, our scientific writer. So, So what Roland said, what are we talking about? Is it sanitation? Is it wastewater? Actually, that was when we started to discuss this study that became a book. That was actually the starting point for the whole thing. We were starting talking about showing good examples of wastewater recovery, reuse. But then we said, but hey, we cannot talk about wastewater without talking about sanitation. How can we have a like sustainable wastewater management without looking like upstream? In some countries, 90% of all wastewater is coming from like households and normal sanitation systems. So that equation didn't work really. As you can see, you probably are aware of this. It's diverse issues around the world, some leading to more health impacts, some more to environmental challenges. So we also looked at the Sustainable Development Goal and seeing, hey, we need to discuss it around this. This is a framework. It's something that a change that is taking place now. So we need to actually frame our discussion in this context. But interesting, I don't know if it's, they are actually divided here. You have sanitation in 6.2 and you talk about wastewater in 6.3. So no clear connection here either, no? So, but the good thing is that, as Roland pointed out, this is, we at least at SCI, we see the SDGs as really a good base to start to really work on a global scale on sustainability when it comes to sanitation and wastewater management. So the question is how far we will get. The MDGs looked a lot about on the toilets, the access to sanitation, while the SDGs, they start to talk about treatment, but also mentioning recycling, resource recovery. So the question is how far we can get. But we think we have to try to motivate to go as far as we can to the right. So we mapped some of the issues, and if you start to look, it's sanitation up to the left. We have the communicable diseases to the right, water scarcity and malnutrition, and you can see that there's some regions in the world that this is actually coinciding. And we think that doing sanitation different can at least respond to some of these issues. So what we did, we also tried to map then. If you do more with sanitation, so it's quite hard to see this. We have a poster on the door outside, and of course you can look in the book when it's launched. But it says waste containment in the first column, then it says safe sanitation access and availability, pathogen control, nutrient emission control, and then to the right you have resource management and recovery. So we looked at, by doing a more sustainable, more going towards resource recovery in sanitation and wastewater management, how many goals can you kind of address and contribute to? And you can see if we go all the way up to resource management and recovery and complete the other functions of sanitation, then we can actually address 34 different targets. So that's quite impressive. But we think it's so important to frame and discuss further what do we really mean by sustainability. Sometimes it's taken quite lightly, and we feel like this, we have to go into the different topics of sustainability and provide more evidence and arguments. But if we want resource, if we really care about resources and the management, and we think there is actually resource scarcity coming around the corner, then we think it's important to really put stress on this. So we put that in the middle, actually. But it's based on the SuSanA sustainability criteria, and it's all there. So what does this mean? When we come to like
practically, how do we do that? How do we put resources first? We think there is kind of a need of a paradigm shift. When we do developing projects or setting up new projects in a new town, for example, we actually need to start to look, what are the resources there? What's the scarcity? What's the demands? What type of resource management options are there to get energy out, maybe reuse water in irrigation around the city? And then at the end, when we know more or less what we want to do, then we can start to talk about how do we do it? What kind of technical systems do we need? Is it centralized, decentralized? Is it waterborne or is it non-waterborne? But that each context we'll have to define that. Doing this this way, we think then we can reach to this more multiple potential benefits. This is just another way to show it. The value of the waste. We have a lot of different waste streams in our society. Human excreta is one, but there are others. And actually, they are not waste. It's energy in some form, nutrients, organic matter, water. And we have different options, as I said. And so in the book, we also then look at what's the value of what's the added value of doing resource management and recovery. This is just a case of Vientiane, where there's a lot of contamination of wetlands in the city. And if we start to do different, and it's really depending on wastewater not being treated, left out there. So if we start to collect, for example, harvest the plants in the wetlands, start to emptying the septic tanks, then we can produce biogas with the material we get out, the biosolids. We have a fertilizer. It could be combined maybe with urine separation. So, and then we could have a lot of good benefits, water saving. We have more sustainable fertilizers, reduction of CO2 emissions, etc. So then we go into the other dimension of sustainability. We're looking at the institutional social aspects, of course. What are actually the enabling environment is really important to know what you want to do in the planning. But what we thought is important, if you really want to do resource management and resource recovery, we have to understand also that there are new user group or new spheres of actors that we don't have in sanitation normally, or in wastewater management either. So we have a user group that is the common one, but then we have someone doing the treatment. We have somebody doing the reuse, and then we have consumers buying these products once again. So we need actually to consider this as it's a whole new governance institutional setup that we require, and of course trust between these groups. In a really small scale, in a rural village, this could happen in one household, of course, but when we are talking about urban areas, for example. Then, of course, we have the health part. We dive into some strategies there. Multi-barrier approach recommended by the WHO. That you need integrated wash. Also, that you have to really identify where in the system you have critical issues, because it will not just, as I said, with a different use. What do you call it? Actors in the when you want resource recovery, it will also be in this case we will have more potential risk points in the system. So one tool that could be used and is discussed is the sanitation safety planning that was launched last year, I guess. We have the environmental dimension protecting, but also enhancing. We can combine wastewater treatment with natural treatment system and provide new ecosystem services, for example. Technical functionality, I think I've been into that a little bit. The important is that we also think of sustained functions when we design and operate design the operation maintenance, for example. When it comes to treatment options, we all have to think that now, if we're going to reuse and recover different streams, there might be, in some cases, we don't, if we want to reuse, for example, wastewater as irrigation, we have to look at pathogens, micropollutants. But if we're going to use reuse as a drinking water, then we have to maybe get rid of organic material as well. So depending on what we want to have out of the resource. And then we're looking a bit about the financial models, the importance of cost-benefit analysis. The World Bank has done a great job looking at the MDGs and also started to look at the SDGs when it comes to what will it cost, look at some of the benefit and costs, and showing that actually doing sanitation, improved sanitation, will generate economic benefits. But then what is still to be do is to actually look at this from a resource management point of view as well, and see how this could even provide even more arguments for sanitation and wastewater management. And at the end of the book, we are showcasing good examples of resource recovery from small scale to larger scale in different areas. Examples from Sweden, for example, is black water recycling. Bolivia, we have more of urine diverting dry toilets, that kind of project. In Brazil, we have two cases, one on grey water recycling, another one on reuse of sewage sludge. From Namibia, we have the reclamation, wastewater reclamation to groundwater recharge, and recycling for drinking water, etc. I have to stop now. But it was, the idea was to give you some glimpses of our new book that we are launching on Monday, 5:45 in SCI booth on the top floor, I think, in the Water Week venue. And there is the book will be available for downloads. So go ahead and share, and we hope it's going to be useful for the different communities and different actors, and maybe a base for also for this discussion that Roland talks about. What, how do we define these terms? Okay, thank you.
And I saw among the authors list as well Elisabeth Kranström.
Yeah, yeah.
And she's as well sort of in the author group together with Roland. So I think she can as well really bring the broader picture as well into the thought process of the background document. One or two comments while Daniela Krahl is getting ready with her presentation, please.
Sorry, hi. My name is Chad Brookin from Free Flow Consulting. One comment I have is that I'm noticing a lot of focus on energy production, and I think that our focus should really be on food production. If we're ingesting food in our bodies and we're creating waste from it, you know, there's a byproduct, of course, of, you know, biogas. But do you feel that the industry or the temperature in the industry is more toward energy or more toward food production?
Yeah, that's a good point. From our perspective, we haven't put more emphasis on energy, actually. We think the food production part is as important or even more important. But I guess, as you say, maybe if you look at the wastewater sector and the industry, it is easier for them, of course, to start to produce energy from their wastewater treatment plants. But to start to reuse, then you need to convince the farmers that you have a clean product, etc. So, of course, there's a lot of more barriers to get to that. So I guess that maybe we should also emphasize it even more now. But we see it as energy is important, but as well as because many parts of the world there's still no energy security, you can say. So it's, yeah.
Food scarcity as well.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe you have to eat first and think of you need energy to eat, maybe. Okay. Yeah.
Now, I just want to emphasize what Jet was saying. You know, we have made major mistakes in the very fast or the very the past about introducing, a linear sanitation system, and which we are dealing with, the problems, today. From my practical background, it's indeed very easy to talk to industries, who have the resources, to turn also sanitation resources into energy, because, that is where they get the profit from, look more into nutrition and food production, because, it's also... the whole issue on phosphorus, has shown, that this is going to be the major issue in the next century. Thanks.
And okay. I just want to comment. I think there is a climate change, I guess, that motivates to do more renewable energy. And I guess one problem is maybe that energy has become an ad hoc to the wastewater treatment plants that's already there. But I think if you in many cases you will start a little bit more from the scratch, and if you have energy as one of the possible resources that you could reuse, I don't think there has to be trade-offs with food production. But I think it should be on the table when you discuss what's the potential solutions and what do you want to achieve in your specific case. So
okay. Last.
And yes, thank you. But also very, Ada Oko-Williams from WaterAid. Also very related to that, I think our discussion or our thinking shouldn't really be which is more important or more urgent right now, because I see both of them equally important. But I'll just give a classical example of why, for example, I personally would be very interested in energy. A country like Nigeria, that it's huge in terms of population as far as the African continent is concerned. But that's a country that is grappling with energy challenges. And I can just imagine, and we all recognize how much energy can just be a catalyst for in the entire development process for that country. So it really needs to be taken in context where we're promoting what, because some countries just need. And then there's a lot of food production that is being wasted because there's no energy to transform those, food produce to something know that the country and the people can continue to use in different ways. Basically, what I'm trying to say is it shouldn't be a case of which is more important, but more of in what context. Where is what needed the most? Yeah.
No, I actually can support that with a case from, for example, Ethiopia. I mean, in the countryside, people are really burning everything they are. So, it's really getting into an environmental issue. Getting the energy security in the households. So if they can start to process and do anaerobic digestion and biogas production on a household level, then they will still have some biosolids that can go back to the field. So for example, there's a lot of gains there. So I think we shouldn't just say energy has to come long down the line. I think it has to come up front as well, and then we have to see in each case what are the most important aspects that we have to take into consideration.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Kim.
Thanks.
Yes, and I think in the beginning there was a lot of discussion in SuSanA about food production. Then it was saying that what actually are the different opportunities which are there. Now we as well say that look first for the highest opportunity and then design the sanitation system that you actually cater to the need of the resource that you might use. So I think that's how the discussion develops here, and in a broader sense, put it in the center of all the SDGs. Thanks, Kim. And now I'm very happy to announce Daniela Krahl, who will bring as well one aspect of the bigger picture. We're sort of opening up at the moment the SuSanA discussions on from MDG to SDG. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Arne. On behalf of BMZ, the ministry I work for, I would like to thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk about the ideas on what does it mean to bring the Agenda 2030 to implementation on a ministerial level. It's not the level you're working on, but nevertheless, it is very interesting, I think, for you, because in the end, it has a lot of impact to all the other stakeholders in the water and sanitation area. Well, as you have heard today from the speakers we had here before, water is a central element in the new agenda, and it is mentioned in the text in several parts. I think I should not go into detail how it's mentioned, but as you see, protection of the planet and its natural resources, there is one point where water comes in. The other is human rights to safe drinking water and sanitation, efficient use of water and energy. These are the new outlines. Excuse me? Closer, okay. Yes. This is another slide comparable to the one you have seen today. Is what does it mean for the other SDGs that water is in it? But this is an exercise I think all the other people working for the other SDGs are doing as well. So you find presentation, you know, coming from health, showing that without supporting health, all the other SDGs can't be met. But here it is explicitly written, what does it mean? For example, water and 15 is reduction of mainland caused pollution to the seas and so on. This is more specific where the interlinkage between water and the other SDGs are. And the interlinkage is all sometimes meant as risks. If you go too far to the one goal, you will it's difficult for the other, so it's a contrary goal. Some are synthesis, so you can meet two goals at the same time, as we have in water and sanitation, sanitation and health. Here are some more important highlighted. In SDG 3, good health, we have a target that addressing containment of waterborne diseases, reducing the infant mortality rate. So if you don't address hygiene and toilets, you won't reduce the infant mortality rate. And it doesn't matter how much you do with good nutrition. Then sanitation is the bottleneck. So here, maybe the most important highlighted, where we have started to do more strategic work. But the main topic of my presentation is the global water architecture. That means the architecture of the UN institutions. We think that one of the main problems in the past, that in the MDG area, that in the sanitation area, was that the UN was not well positioned. And we have started an initiative among some countries on a ministry level, doing some analysis and creating a new vision and ideas where the UN system could go to. The analysis shows that the global water governance structure in the UN system is highly fragmented, with single-issued perspectives. And in contrast to other SDGs, there is no dedicated UN intergovernmental body. So the high political leaders can't have a voice on water in the UN. There is currently very little regular dialogue between major groups and governments on water aspects, and the new mindset of the SDGs is not reflected. That there is where the other stakeholders come in. And there is currently no counterpart for intergovernmental bodies of other sectors, let's say for health, for food security, for climate, for agriculture. They have quite important and well-working intergovernmental bodies, but there is no talk on an equal level to water because there is no intergovernmental body. So water is one of the major risk factors in the years to come, and therefore there is a need for such a body. So far, the analysis. And if you try to bring it to a picture, but I was criticized by showing this picture because one of the audience said he had counted the little signs in the middle. There are just 31, but there are nearly 50 different UN bodies working with water, so it's not enough. There should be more. So what does it show? There are a lot of UN organizations, programs working in the field of water, with impact to water. They have more or less a well-established reporting line to the high-level, the HLPF, and they have more or less a defined way to ECOSOC, and this is all well-organized to the General Assembly. Where comes water in? In the UN we have something that is called UN Water. UN Water is just a technical organization. Member states are not member of UN Water. UN Water is just a technical coordination of UN organizations. So it's just there, and the UN organizations are member of UN Water. So that they are bit closer, but it's a very weak technical coordination thing and has no mandate to bring anything to the HLPF or to talk to member states. But since the Agenda 2030 was published, two new high-level panels were created, the Global High-Level Panel on Water and Peace and the High-Level Panel on Water, that was done this year in January, where World Bank and some governments are member. These high-level panels show that there is an increasing need for countries on a high political level to express their concerns. But these high-level panels do not belong to the UN. And there are only a handful or two handful countries or member there. So Germany is not member of one of them, for example. Swiss is, but it's not really representative, and it does not really help. They do not any work. And then we have the monitoring organizations. So that's the way it is. What would it mean to have a fit for purpose architecture? The most important thing, that the new body should be mandated by all UN member states. So it should be mandated by the General Assembly. So there must be some countries to write a resolution that the mandate can be given. This is up to the states. Stakeholders cannot write a resolution to the General Assembly. But it is important that the multi-stakeholders and the networks are engaged in the new body. So this has to be addressed in the resolution, even though the multi-stakeholders can't write the resolution. It's not meant to be. The task and the functioning, it has to be is described, but there are paperwork done already on that, so the vision is quite clear what they should do. Then we have discussion on the role of UN Water. We have the UNSCOP final report. UNSCOP recommends that this report is recommending that UN Water should be strengthened, so that it can be the secretary for this new body. But there is a lot of discussion right now going on, and it will be discussed here on the Water Week, for example, on Monday on the high-level panel on water architecture, especially the role of UN Water or the role of other UN bodies. That is the main discussion, the recent discussion right now. Should the new secretary be linked to existing UN bodies, or should with UN Water be created a new UN body? There are pros and cons, and I would say if you link the secretary for the new body to one of the existing, then you don't, then the existing always comes from a special side. It's not the holistic approach. It can't cover the holistic approach, and only a new body could be independent and cover the complete vision of the agenda. But there are discussions going on, so I leave it to the conference, and it's not decided yet. Well, maybe some last words to the integration of major groups and other stakeholders. Representation and participation of major groups have to be essential elements for intergovernmental body. The whole agenda has been developed and adopted in this spirit, so it's fundamental in it, it's the essence. The participation of major groups will help stimulate and energize its work and give publicity to it. And after all, the states cannot do it alone. Implementation needs all actors to work together, the private sector and the civil society. And as long as we had the UNSCOP, the UNSCOP was acting as the independent voice for all water sectors, but UNSCOP has finished its work end of last year, so it's not there anymore. The final report, we think, is a good guideline how we should address the problems in a way that we can solve the challenges. And I think the last thing maybe is sharing experience and learning from each other is key for the successful implementation of the SDGs. So we have to be there in the UN at a very high level and bring all the different perspectives together. I hope I'm still in time. There are much more points, but it's an ongoing open discussion. It's of most importance right now in the ministries. So this is my insight I would like to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniela, for giving us an insight on that level. You showed the, yes, that one. We can consider to put SuSanA somewhere, no? Yeah. And no, it's not. I'm not suggesting it. But if you, if people are saying there are not enough logos on it, so then we always could offer one. No, but more serious, I invite some voices from the floor, Roland, and maybe others to comment, please.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm wondering, are you also considering? I mean, we have a UN organization on health. We have one on food. We have one on many different issues. I know we talked about in the last 20, several times that it was defeated, but I think maybe that's the moment. Are you talking about, or is that basically the end result of the whole exercise? And maybe another comment about UN Water. I think as long as UN Water is just a coordinating agency, we saw it in the development of the SDG, extremely weak. Because extremely weak, because they always say we have to take care of all these 40 plus organizations, and so they never came up with at the end they did come up with some position, but it was basically not their own.
Yes. There was another voice.
I guess the question is, it seems common sense that there shouldn't be this disconnect between water and wastewater. Like, wastewater it's in the name. So why do, like, all these water organizations, do they not realize that wastewater is the resource? And, you know, there is clean water, and then we shit in it. Why are we shitting in our drinking water is another question I have.
Well, at the UN level, that
doesn't happen.
But these organizations, they're covering food, energy, the health, and not the difference between water and sanitation. So this difference is not reflected on this level. Yes. So the new body should cover the complete SDG 6 and the water-related targets to the other SDGs.
Yes, while we have maybe one or two more questions, we can get the presentation of Kate ready. Yes?
Yeah.
Yes, but your question was, you didn't finish really, do you?
Yes, you would like to have an answer. The future of UN water?
No.
In this discussion, is it also discussed about having a UN organization on water?
Yes, that is.
Okay.
And the thing is about mandating, resolution, and finance. And we have to bring together the finance of member states, the finance the UN system has by its own. Then it's very different if you go via resolution on the General Assembly to address the General Secretary, or to address with a resolution directly an UN organization. So these are the tricky questions that follow directly after that. I did not go into these details. So we work on different alternatives which are realistic.
Okay, thanks again, Daniela. Huh? Okay, we had sort of a glimpse on what could be the vision document 2 or whatever it is. We had the book on SEI. We had now the UN level and the architecture around it. And Kate will enlighten us now about monitoring. I always think that however it is, something will come out and the question will be, then how are you doing it on the ground? Mm-hmm. And I don't know, Kate, what you will tell us. What comes out or how are you doing on the ground? But the floor is
probably
yours.
Thank you. Is this working? Okay, so that's actually kind of a nice segue because I've just come from the UN water meeting where all of this architecture was discussed. And to quickly respond to your question there, as the Agency for Health, I can tell you we absolutely do look at water and wastewater together. In fact, we have health-based guidelines for all parts of the water cycle on drinking water, on wastewater, on recreational water, and also the links to nutrition, to neglected tropical diseases. It's kind of all there. So we are very much trying to take an integrated look at this. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Kate Medlicott. I'm the sanitation team leader at WHO. I'm not part of the JMP team, but I work alongside them with a focus on 6.3 together with Graham Alabaster, who's here with you today. And so we're going to go from this very kind of broad discussion we've just had about the monitoring architecture, which is, you know, and not just the monitoring architecture, but the whole UN architecture around water. I'm going to zoom in now on just a really specific piece of this, which is a proposed methodology for monitoring target 6.2 and 6.3. And to really highlight that this is a draft and we've got a very long way to go. We're looking at building a monitoring instrument that will serve us for the next 15 years, but also understanding that we've actually got some really short timeframes ahead of us. We need to get baseline reports out soon, and that involves a lot of complicated things dealing with huge variability in data, big data gaps, and also the whole interaction with countries. So as the global monitoring instrument, we of course are recipients of the data. We need to respect the processes and data availability in countries. So with that in mind, I just want to present to you some of the thinking that has been going on, and with thanks especially to Andy Peel and Luca DiMario, Barbara, who presented this yesterday at the SFD meeting, and Graham and I who have been working on it as well. So I think it was Roland that was saying, well, several people have said that we can't separate out wastewater and sanitation, and the approach taken for global monitoring is sort of respecting that idea as well. So looking at this really in two parts, the wastewater from households, so building on the JMP, and looking at wastewater from economic activities or industries. So we'll talk about the two of those slightly separately. But I just wanted to quickly step out how they, I don't think anybody here really needs a lesson in this. You're all sanitation practitioners, so know it well. But essentially we're looking at the combination of wastewater from households, from industry, the combined effect on water quality, ambient water quality that is, and recognising that there are huge flows from agriculture, but they're very difficult to monitor at source, so really trying to pick up those in the monitoring of ambient water quality. And of course, if we're able to get these two indicators working together, then we will have a nice metric on the sources of pollution and their combined impact on ambient water qualities and, by extension, drinking water quality. So these are the two parts we'll talk about. I think many people are very familiar with this now, so I'm just going to be talking about 6.2 and 6.3 and these indicators, which you probably also know are not 100% finalised yet, but the concrete is starting to set around them, and hopefully by March we'll know for sure what the indicators will be. But you'll see there's there's new terminology, safely managed sanitation and safely treated wastewater. So I'll just skip to the sanitation part and what the definition of that means. So this is an extension of the MDG period definition. So we're talking about sanitation services that are not shared and where excreta is safely disposed in situ or transported and treated off-site, which seems straightforward enough, and still you start digging into it a little bit more. So again, I think we're all very familiar with the MDG sanitation ladders, and this new rung, this safely managed sanitation is really proposed as a new rung on the ladder. So going, it's not that we would stop monitoring basic sanitation or improved sanitation, but looking at the proportion of those that have improved sanitation who actually have a safely managed sanitation service. So essentially what we're talking about is monitoring the full sanitation chain, which has been shown in others' presentations. And to make sure that we capture the specifics of the sewage and on-site systems. From a global monitoring perspective, of course, the sewage is the easiest data to get at from utilities, but I think we all know that, you know, the vast majority of sanitation is actually on-site, so we need to kind of get our hands dirty a bit and try and capture this this data on what's happening with on-site systems. So what this is really kind of a back-end tool to look at how you actually calculate this amount of safely managed sanitation, and just a way of trying to organize the data in a way that kind of makes sense and makes sure we're capturing the complexity of what's going on. So what you'll see here is the sanitation ladder as we know it, open defecation, unimproved, shared, and then these other categories are on improved on and off-site facilities, and trying to see, you know, if we plug in the JMP data to the left side, what percentages of that is really safely disposed in situ, and how much is treated either at a fecal sludge treatment plant or a wastewater treatment plant. And that would give us a calculation of the proportion that's safely managed. But I think we all know that, unfortunately, it's not quite that simple, that there's losses along the sanitation chain, and we'd like to progress eventually to be able to kind of capture these as well. So, you know, understanding that a lot of what is emptied or goes into a sewer doesn't actually make it to treatment. That there's, yeah, again, and then a lot of what is
which goes into a toilet is actually not contained, either sewers that are going to open drains, for example. Skip through that. So here's just kind of an example. This is from a country in Latin America. We're just seeing what this might look like and as we would go from the MDG period to the SDG period. So on the far left there, you can see that the JMP ladders, this is actually for Peru, where they have currently 74% improved sanitation. When we transition to safely managed sanitation, you can visualize it using a SFD style approach, which is one way of representing this to see where the losses are. But essentially, the output would show you that just actually 30% in Peru is actually safely managed. So this presents an enormous challenge, a communication challenge, as well as an implementation challenge for everybody in the sector. I think we're seeing a lot of countries who are frankly a bit shocked, thinking they'd done so well in the MDGs and going, what? We've suddenly gone down from 74% to 30%. Others think, well, that's great. You know, the MDGs, we'd sort of finished that work and we're happy to have a new challenge. So there's a couple of ways of looking at this. But what we can be sure of is that there's a huge communication challenge around this for all of us about how we integrate this into our work, how we explain it to our partners, and what that means in the kind of implementation we're doing. So I think the MDG approach of talking about improved sanitation sort of drove us, not entirely, but more towards infrastructure style projects. How do we get more improved facilities out there? When we talk about safely managed services, I think it forces us to think about much more about the kind of service delivery. So it's a different mindset that we need to kind of get our head around. And I think, Roland, I just caught the end of your presentation and you said, oh, there's no indicator for reuse. And you know, you're right, there's no specific indicator for it, but we're doing a little bit of thinking with some of the people in this group about definitions around treatment and what is safely treated. Because essentially, from a data management perspective, you kind of somehow have to kind of say, that's safely treated, that's not. And it's a complicated thing to do. So this is kind of a think piece that we're working on, essentially looking at this, and this is for wastewater treatment, there's a similar one for fecal sludge, but essentially trying to think about that in terms of what is the level of treatment that's provided. So that's the treated part of safely treated, and then a public health dimension sort of saying, well, you know, how fit for purpose is that treatment that's been given, and looking at just some very simple exposure scenarios. So for example, well, the easy one here would be to say, well, if you've got primary treatment with a long ocean outfall, you can probably call that safely managed. If you've got primary treatment that's being used for food production, then you wouldn't. So it kind of gets this notion of reuse in there, even though we don't have a specific indicator on it. But again, getting the data for this is really our challenge. So essentially what we're trying to do is to make a sort of a simple graphical overview of the sources and sinks of unsafe wastewater and sanitation, and sort of building on what's become very commonly used now, I think, with this SFD kind of representation. It's trying to be a little bit intervention neutral. I don't think we want to be driving, we don't want global monitoring to be driving investment in any specific technology, but more to say, well, look, here is the situation at a national level, and it's blunt because it's national level, of course, and to sort of drive a policy level discussion on allocation of resources and priorities. It builds on the JMP data, so at least at the start of the left-hand side of the approach, we have So statistically representative data, as we go to the right-hand side, the data becomes a bit more shaky. I've covered that last point. So I just wanted to cover this second part now, and Graham, you're very welcome to speak up or let me know if I'm getting this wrong, but we're talking more about now about the industrial part of it, because I think here as sanitation people, we're quite comfortable with saying sanitation and wastewater are the same thing, but there's other wastewater people who, you know, understandably want to make sure all these other components of wastewater are properly addressed. So essentially the approach that we're looking at here is an inventory, so capturing all of the inventory types, trying to get a metric on the approximate size of the industry, looking at where it's discharging to, and its hazard classification, and finally whether it's in or out of compliance with its discharge permit, so that that proportion, that part of the indicator would be a proportion of the hazardous effluent over the total hazardous effluent generated. So we have two components of the safely treated wastewater indicator. So I think that's all I have to say on that. And I think there's probably lots of questions. So maybe I'll open up for that if there's time.
Thanks very much, Kate. So I think we've got, I know we're running a bit late, but this is such an interesting subject. we should, if there's any questions or comments you'd like to make, try and be as brief as you can, because we are a bit tight on time.
1, 2, 3. Okay, 4. Maybe we collect?
Yeah, yeah, okay.
So very quickly, I'd like to make a link between Roland's presentation and your presentation. I thought it was very interesting to see that now the goals are universal, and now the goal is sustainability. And if we keep the disposal as one of the options in the end, then what do the developed countries have to do? Because on all the other steps, they are good. It's probably close to 100%, yet the sanitation is not sustainable, because in the end it always ends in a water body. So I think the real goal is absolutely the reuse, and as long as the loop is not closed, then it's not sustainable.
Okay, yeah. A couple more comments before
we ask Kate. That's very short. I again saw the flush toilet as a symbol of sanitation, and I now start to be a little bit obnoxious about it, and I think we should at least drop the flush from the toilet. Because the symbol of household sanitation is a flush toilet, and I think you're getting the wrong message across. I mean, and the UN Water, has that, and now see that you are using it again, and now I'm getting a little bit. Yes. And the other question is, and that is, we have had long discussions on shared toilet facilities, and I see again that it's a kind of a limbo. And for many, many people, that's the only option. And I wonder, and actually I was surprised that it again came up as a kind of a not so good kind of thing.
One more comment you want to get to.
Well, the segue is directly into mine. Is I appreciate that it's intervention neutral, and that the end goal is safely managed sanitation. And so whether it's a shared or not shared toilet, the latter sort of indicates that there's a progression where, in fact, you might have a very good, safely managed, shared option that we need to be recognizing.
Kate, do you want to respond to those?
No. I can do that. I mean, they're all really good points. I mean, on the sustainability one, yes. I mean, unfortunately, to some extent, for richer countries, how they interpret that indicator, I think they can build a lot more nuance into safety managed and sustainable, and I hope they do. The flush toilet, yes, we will try to use it. This point taken, absolutely. Shared is a much more complicated one, and I think you're probably going to see the terminology for shared and transitioning to what's called a limited service, and I think we're waiting to see a bit stronger evidence of some of those
shared facilities with a safely managed service chain. That's an interesting combination that hasn't really come through on the data yet. But unfortunately, the epidemiological studies for sharing are still pointing to that it's bad for health, unfortunately. So from a simple perspective of, is this meeting the criteria of preventing human contact with excreta, the epidemiology is not really supporting that shared provides that. So, but we understand that there's a really, really intense debate around this. Yeah.
Okay. Could continue, or you add something?
No.
Ruan, I saw your thing.
Hi, this is Sarah Dickin from SCI. I forgot to say that, my last question. I'm going to be starting some research looking at gender vulnerability related to WASH, and I was wondering how that is going to be monitored or how data will be collected to look at gender differentiated access.
Mm-hmm. Okay, a couple of other quick interventions.
I start here, and then I come to you, Roland, in a minute. Mira, please.
Yeah, something that I asked Barbara yesterday, but how will you address the issues in monitoring for the remaining part of the service chain, because that cannot be captured by household surveys. Mm-hmm. Something that we've discussed, but I know what you are thinking of doing and what has happened in the POC countries. That is what my interest is.
Sure.
Okay. One more quick comment then.
Just a small comment to the shared. I thought it was not a question about shared or not shared, but shared by how many.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So
I think recent studies have shown that if it goes up to, I think, six families, or I don't remember now, or five, yes, or five, then it's okay. So I think it's not shared or not shared, but I think they have to differentiate it. Just a small comment.
Okay, over to you.
Yeah, I'm a bit hesitant to get deeper into the shared one, except to say that yes and no. on the gender differentiated data, so what the JMP is really looking to do now is thematic reports that capture some of these specific issues. I mean, there's lots of things that the household surveys can't do very well, like migrant populations, like getting into gender disparities, intra-household disparities. There's a number of things, and they're trying to capture those a bit better in thematic reports. But at its core, the JMP uses household-based data, so that's the kind of the lowest level of disaggregation we can get. And there's kind of the wealth quintiles, some things around age, but you're probably not going to get the kind of granularity of gender disaggregated data you might be hoping for there. In terms of your question, Mira, about the getting the data, so there's kind of two ways of looking at this. If we look at what we have to do in the next year, then it's going to be a bit rough and ready and whatever we can get, frankly, a big data drive, just pulling in whatever we can and trying to make sense of it for a baseline. But over the longer term, what we're doing already is testing new questions that can go into household surveys. You're right, you can't get the whole sanitation chain from households, but you can get a bit of information about emptying and transport, perhaps from households. And so we're looking at testing those and transitioning them into the large household surveys slowly over time. And then linking that with better service provider data acquisition. So, for example, IBNet is looking at adding new questions that would pick up on the treatment that would be aligned with SDG monitoring purposes. But as always, the big gap is how we get at service providers for on-site services. And we have some questionnaire tools we're working on with that, and I think you've seen them. And how we kind of start getting that done at scale, I think, is our big challenge.
Okay, I think we'll call it. I know there's lots to discuss, but I think in interest of time, we have one more presentation, and I think we should move on. So if you've got any other questions, come and see Kate or myself afterwards. So the final, thank you very much, Kate.
Either.
So the final presentation we've got this afternoon is about regional political processes. So Vishwanath, the floor is yours.
That's the Twitter handle and the Facebook handle. Zen Rainman, so to be in communication and in touch. Just a sort of a snapshot and a quick view and an abstract view of what's happening in the Indian context with toilets. So I think for the first time in India, we've got the Prime Minister backing a sanitation drive, standing from the Red Fort on our Independence Day. The target set is phenomenal. 110 million toilets to be built by October 2nd, 2019. So we're far ahead of the SDG goals in terms of the toilet construction. So 20 million toilets have been built in the last 2 years, from August 15 to 2016. It's a phenomenal number. You're going to get another 90 million toilets very quickly. So to put it in perspective, before India could not achieve the Millennium MDGs in terms of sanitation. It did not achieve the MDG target for sanitation. But in terms of the SDG, at least in terms of toilet construction, it set itself an ambitious toilet target. So this is what it says, the government statistics and figures. All government schools are now covered with toilets, separate toilets for boys and girls, about so many toilets built. And in creches, which are for children between the age of 0 and 4, this is the kind of toilet construction that seems that's happened. All this is sort of live, and it's on the website of the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. And it's updated almost hourly. The figures are updated hourly. With the technology choice, it's the pore flush, squatting, twin pit toilet. That's the technological choice. And 110, 120 million toilets will be built, which will be pore flush. Not UDDT, not the toilet challenge toilets, none. The twin pit toilet. And I think at some point of time, SuSanA has to come out with a specific recommendation of what it thinks about the twin leach pit toilet and what it thinks is sustainable or not sustainable about it, and how will it go. Subsidy driven, completely subsidy driven. There will be a CLTS model in the beginning to drive demand, generate demand, and then there will be a subsidy that follows. Some states, and India operates differently for each state, some states have enhanced the subsidy also. Performance has been different for many states. And that's it. So this is the toilet model. Unfortunately, in many states, only a single pit is being built. The hope is that a twin pit will be added. No evidence to show that people have built a second pit later on. So it stays at a single pit. Some states are building twin pits. And so that has its implications, as you will all know. The positive fact is that there's this huge political push behind it. And when the Prime Minister pushes the message, it gets listened to right now, with the new Prime Minister especially. It's a great deal of advertisement drive, communication in the mass media, everywhere people are going. There's a separate team, a sort of a third-party inspection that's also going on by the Ministry of Rural Development for the toilets, national-level monitors, as they're called. And they go and check and report on the progress being reported by the state governments. There's been a huge amount of confusion there because the data have not tallied with what's been reported on the ministry's website and when the national level monitors go. And when the national level monitor goes in April and then he goes again in August, there seems to be a mismatch between those figures too. So a whole amount of reconciliation is happening because the numbers are huge. Corporate social responsibility funds are coming in. Companies have to devote 2% of their profits as corporate social responsibility. And this year, the balance money which was unspent by the large corporations was transferred to the government fund for toilet construction. So that's what's happening. There's a $1.5 billion loan from the World Bank, which is coming for the Swachh Bharat mission. Therefore, the current budgetary provisions may not seem to be enough, but it looks like it's going to be supplemented by the World Bank loan. The challenges are, of course, the delivery of subsidy to the household. Huge bureaucratic delays. Usage as opposed to construction shows a figure of 50%. So you can count the toilets, but how do you count usage? And that continuously remains a challenge. How do you count the usage? Drought last year was phenomenal, was very profound. It affected 360 million people. And which means that if you have a poor flush toilet, it looks like there's a huge implication on that. There's no data or evidence to suggest what it is, but anecdotal evidence and reports from various habitations have suggested that people have shifted back to OD because they do not have enough water to drink. And that will be a continuous challenge as things go forward. Getting to twin pits from single pits, emptying of pits, and safe management of pit sludge manure remains to be addressed. So that disposal system mechanism is still not in place. What has to happen with it? And of course, the alternatives for flood-prone areas, hard rock terrain, typical areas where the UDDT you think would work, that's not been explored enough in large numbers to suggest that it's a good alternative. But, and that will naturally come. But what we will do, I suspect, is that we'll build the twin pit pore flush toilets. We'll find that they don't work in the flood-affected areas, and then we'll replace them with other alternatives as things go forward. So we are condemned to suboptimality, and therefore the thoughts that I've been hearing is that we seem to be aiming for the ideal with the SDGs and with what we want as nutrient recovery. But I think what people want first is access to toilets, and then comes the reuse part, and then comes the nutrient recovery part. So in the hope of getting the ideal toilet to people, do you deprive them of the first choice of accessing a safer sanitation rather than safe or completely safe sanitation? That will be the issue that will be with us. Again, the role of the informal sector. All these toilets are being built by masons, by labor, but not by formal companies, not by formal businesses. It's being done locally, as local as you can get. Now, they're simply not recognized in any format. I think there are now some training, human resource capacity building exercises, but that's for more the officials and implementers. But those who are actually building, they don't seem to be getting any help. And this is the question that remains. So when SEI puts up its framework and leaves out the legal framework, you talk about institutions, social frameworks, technical frameworks, but the legal framework is crucial in the Indian context because the key driver for sanitation is still the abolition of manual scavenging. People going down manholes, people going down into pit toilets, removing it manually. So the question is, even with the twin pit, if we do not have a legal framework and a standard to say when is shit shit and when is it manure, we don't have a definition so far. I haven't read any definition anywhere which suggests that when is it that you... So is this a biological construct? Do we talk about hookworms, protozoa, or bacteria? Is it a social construct when you see human waste as shit and therefore untouchable, because the untouchability and the caste comes from a social construct? It doesn't come from a biological construct or a physical construct as to where it's arriving from. So how do we encompass all three? Because if we want to make nutrient recovery and application as manure, unless we address these cultural, social, biological, and physical aspects of human waste, I don't think we'll be progressing very far. I think that's all about I had to share. Snapshot.
Yes, I think we have the Indian chapter on the SuSanA website. I think that's important guidance. Help us that these things are thought there. I had a feedback that every school has a toilet means every school has now a plan to have a toilet.
It's a completed toilet.
It's a completed one. So then that's
and
really
a separate
breathtaking
toilet for boys and girls.
Wow,
that's what's reported.
Online, hourly updated. Okay,
that's updated. Yes, hourly.
Okay, so that's really great and good news. Questions, comments, please. One, two. Is there a second mic we can move around? There's the second mic, please.
Thanks. I'm really curious to follow up on your comment about that you think these toilets are going to be put into place and then down the road go, whoops, we need to replace it. My first training that I provided in India was in 2004, and I was toured around to all of these UNICEF-constructed and other organizations-constructed toilets that were being used for other purposes. And so to echo comments earlier about the 80s were the decade of water, and now is this the decade of sanitation with the risk of exactly the same sort of thing cycling through? Curious on your comments. And what we might do to...
Maybe the next two questions?
Yeah. Kim Anderson, SEI. My question is, I visited one of these government projects in India, and it's interesting how... these systems are often built just next to water wells in the villages. I felt that there was no understanding about the risk of, I mean, before the people went out to the field to defecate, but actually now they're defecating in the village. It's being flushed down the material, and there they have take their water just next to it. So actually they can create new health hazards if you don't have that that notion and that understanding, I think.
Yep.
Yeah.
You comment? I think the suboptimality question is what I think we're condemned to that. I don't think we have the skill set or the speed, because the targets demanded by the Prime Minister and by the Government of India is driving us to count numbers, irrespective of whatever happens. So you're going to count that first, and you're going to take it off and say, okay, this has got constructed, and then you'll worry about how to retrofit it and how to make it cleaner. But will there be monies available? Will there be subsidies available for that? That'll be a question mark. And the question of groundwater contamination, 85% of India's rural population gets drinking water from groundwater. And you're building twin pit toilets, and especially in high water table areas, it's a huge challenge. Is anything being done about that? Nothing, so far.
Okay. I think we could go on long, but I would like to warn you that you have no gap after this session, yeah. And we'll dive into the emergency session. I think it's the appropriate title.